Tridimas is a leading scholar in the field of European Union law. He's one of the most frequently quoted authors by advocates general of the European Court of Justice and on matters of EU law by English courts. He joined our law school in September 2013. And prior to that, he was the Sir John Lubbock Professor of Banking Law at Queen Mary College, University of London. He has also served as référendaire law clerk to Advocate General Sir Francis Jacobs at the European Court of Justice, and he was senior legal advisor to the EU Presidency and chairman of the committee set up by the EU Council of Ministers to draft the Treaty of Accession of 2003. He's acted as advisor or counsel to many public and private organisations, including the European Central Bank, the European Parliament, the European Commission, and the EU Court of Auditors. Professor Tridimas is also Nancy A. Patterson Distinguished Faculty Scholar and Professor at Pennsylvania State University, and he's a barrister at the Matrix Chambers. And it is my absolute pleasure to introduce him and to welcome him and to hand over to him. Please make welcome Professor Tridimas.
It was a very long introduction, but I don't really deserve it. A more concise way of putting it is to say that I do a lot of things badly. So thank you for coming. The idea, I think, is to throw some ideas about Brexit within the theme of transnationalism. Some of what I'm going to say is already published. Some of it is going to be published, some of it is really thinking aloud. I'm going to do the following things. First of all, try and explore a bit Brexit, the outcome to the referendum, to last June's referendum, and share with you some thoughts. Then zoom into Article 50, which is the procedure that governs the withdrawal process, and try and identify and perhaps suggest solutions to the problems raised by Article 50, and finally discuss a bit this idea of rights, acquired rights, because I think what we have in the case of Brexit is a conflict between sovereign powers that create an international organization and individual rights which result from membership. And these interact in a way that perhaps has no historical precedent. Well, certainly has no historical precedent in that particular form. Let's look a bit at the wider picture. Last June, the majority of the British electorate decided in favour of the United Kingdom withdrawing from the European Union. I think this is, from the point of view of the United Kingdom, probably the most important constitutional reversal since the restoration of monarchy in the 17th century. It signals a major redirection of the trade, of at least the trade, possibly the foreign policy of the United Kingdom. And from the point of view of the European Union, I think it is probably one of the most important events since the establishment of the EU construct back in the 1950s. Here are some general reflections, if you wish. Well, for a start, what are the main issues arising from this? If one were to provide a taxonomy, I suppose they would fall into the following categories. First of all, how did we get here? What are the reasons that might justify the outcome to the referendum? This is a nice question that, of course, social scientists, including lawyers, but mostly political scientists and sociologists have begun to address. So this is a kind of looking back, what time to provide a meta-analysis, what has led us where we are. Second question, and I'm now zooming into more legal questions. Second question, I suppose, is the management of the withdrawal process. How is this to be managed? The United Kingdom has been a member for 40 years, more than that, and the influence of European Union law in the development of the common law has been enormous. So how does one manage the withdrawal process? Now, the management of the withdrawal process, to my mind, entails issues of domestic law, it entails issues of European Union law, and it also entails issues of international law. So that's the second group of questions. A third point is the possible future relationship between the EU and the United Kingdom. What form might it take? How will it shape? What would be the implications of it more generally for a transnational model of governance? A fourth issue I would say is what happens to Europe? What is the implication of Brexit on Europe? I think it is correct to say that the European Union has faced a number of successive crises over the last 6-7 years, and these have included the Eurozone crisis, the financial crisis, the migration crisis, and now Brexit. It's interesting to see how the construct of European integration is going to evolve. You may have seen that a couple of weeks ago the European Commission published a white paper on the future of Europe, outlining certain possibilities, certain models as to how the European construct will evolve. Another group of issues pertains to the United Kingdom. What now for the UK? How is the UK? What will be the implications of disengaging from the European Union for the United Kingdom, for its legal system? One could see membership of the European Union as a parenthesis in the development of the common law. After all, it's only 40 years, the common law has developed for hundreds of years. So I'm not pretending that I'm going to be answering all these questions. I thought it would be nice to map the issues arising. And let me then offer some thoughts, some reflections on what I call picking up the pieces. Where do we stand? What is the first assessment of the Brexit vote? Comment number one, I think the departure of the United Kingdom is a great loss to the European Union. I think, why is it a great loss? Well, both for theoretical and practical reasons. It is a great loss because it shatters the irreversibility outlook of the European paradigm. The integration paradigm has an outlook of irreversibility. The idea is that we are trying to create an ever closer union, and here is a member state making an express choice that it is better off outside. So that in itself is important. Secondly, the United Kingdom is one of the most powerful players in Europe in terms of its economic clout, in terms of its political clout, and also in terms of its good citizenship. It has one of the best records in the enforcement of European Union law. So losing one of your best children cannot be a success. It is a failure. It is also seen as offering perhaps a somewhat different economic outlook because it has a laissez-faire orientation, which is often contrasted with the French dirigisme, the continental idea of more socially orientated democracy. So it creates a balance, if you wish, in the models of capitalism that the European Union embraces, which presumably is now going to be absent. So all in all, bad news and a disappointment. I'm not making by any means the point that the departure of the United Kingdom has been the result of the conduct of the European Union. I'm not making the point that the Union's intransigence has led to the UK to depart. Indeed, you may be aware that last March, exactly a year ago, the then Prime Minister of the United Kingdom came to a new settlement for the country with the European Council, which provided substantial amendments to the free movement of workers. It stretched the EU treaties to the maximum, and it's I think accommodated the United Kingdom. It provided concessions to the United Kingdom that few member states could hope to achieve. So it is were concessions. I think it is highly doubtful that if the concessions were more, the United Kingdom would have voted differently. So I'm not making the point that it is the fault. I'm not putting this in terms of blame, the fault of the European Union. But I would say that the first point to note is that this is I would call it as a constitutional disappointment for the EU constitution. Second point, and that's more of a reservation, a factual observation, the outcome to the referendum has given rise to an enormous amount of uncertainty, an enormous amount of inefficiency. Uncertainty to individuals, because they don't know where they stand, especially individuals who are community nationals, UK nationals living in Europe, or EU citizens living in the United Kingdom, has given rise to an enormous amount of uncertainty for businesses, and it has become the main preoccupation of the civil service since last June. The amount of resources that goes into this has increased exponentially. In other words, there has been a major impact on the cost of public administration. Insofar as one can have objective data, there has been an estimation by the Institute for Government that the annual cost for the restructuring of the Whitehall to manage Brexit will be 65 million per year, and that is based on the operational cost of the Department for exiting the EU and the Department for International Trade for every year that they will operate. I'm not in a position to comment on the accuracy of the data. All I can say is that the Institute for Government is a widely perceived as an organization that follows methodologically sound analysis. Okay. So third point, I think the no vote has placed the United Kingdom and the EU into a trajectory of conflict. There is no doubt that member states of the EU negotiate, and they negotiate hard to protect their own interests within the EU, but they do so under the aegis of shared objectives, of commitment to certain institutions, of commitment to certain processes. Once you're out of the EU, I think this framework no longer applies. To the extent that the decision to leave the European Union views the EU legal framework as an expression of a hegemony from which the United Kingdom should emancipate itself, there is a competitive relationship, and the competitive relationship exists both in the relations between the UK and the EU, and in the relations of each of them vis-a-vis third states. And so there is at least a danger that it will be seen as a zero-sum game. The only way to win is if the other party loses. Okay. Next point, I think it is fair to say, and I'm not making a partisan point, I think it is fair to say that irrespective of the objectives or the motives of individual voters, It is probably difficult to avoid the conclusion that the no vote has empowered illiberal causes. The rejection of EU membership favours anti-immigration policies. It fosters an us and them culture. It is a rejection of a shared citizenship. The idea of leaving the EU is to differentiate between British citizens and citizens from other EU states. I'm not suggesting it is good, I'm not suggesting it is bad, but I think it is correct. It has also promoted other causes with which the no vote may not necessarily be associated. I think it has promoted nationalism, it has promoted xenophobia, it has created politics, it has operated as a source of legitimization for those causes, and has also had an export value for other polities and have gained political capital. Parties in other countries have gained political capital from the referendum, and these are parties that pursue a nationalist agenda. Now, again, I'm keen to emphasize that I'm not making a partisan point. One may well take the view that on a cost-benefit analysis, the empowerment of illiberal causes in the short term is a fair price to pay for regaining sovereignty and the autonomy that will result from Brexit. But I think I would prefer to face an argument which is honest in those terms, rather than an argument which suggests that there is no empowerment of illiberal causes. Okay, next point. I think the referendum has also brought to the fore tensions between direct and indirect democracy. This is for a number of reasons. I think the outcome to the referendum is widely perceived to be at odds with the majority of the views of the parliamentarians in Westminster. The wide perception was that last June, if the members of parliament voted in the Commons and indeed in the Lords, they would have, on the question of whether the country should remain a member of the EU, they would have voted for it to do so. So this leads to a paradox, and the paradox is that a fundamental constitutional decision is taken despite the disagreement of the people's elected representatives in a polity where parliamentary sovereignty is the defining constitutional principle. So the outcome of the referendum, or the referendum, the holding of the referendum itself, signals the triumph of direct democracy over indirect democracy. However, this triumph may be short-lived, and it may be short-lived because the referendum question presented a multi-dimensional decision as a binary choice. Exit from the European Union is only half of the story. The other half is the articulation of an alternative economic and social blueprint on which the referendum question was signed. So what do we have here? We have voters with widely diverse preferences coalescing around the no vote, or indeed around the yes vote. Let's take the no vote, because that was a decisive one. Some voters that voted no view the EU as a threat to democracy. Others are critical of the EU's perceived social orientation, which they see as a threat to economic growth. Yet others accuse the European Union of not allowing enough protectionism. You may recall that last year, when the steel industry in the United Kingdom faced an existential crisis, there were calls for the government to protect it, and accusations that the government would not do so because of EU membership. If the government intervened, then that would be illegal state aid. So And there is another aspect of protectionism, and this is related to migration. Free movement of workers is perceived as a threat to the domestic labor force, and that has again been perceived to be a key point, a key driver behind the no vote. So, in short, the negative message of the referendum, no EU membership, is clear. But the positive message is not clear. Where do we go from here? Since the Brexit vote cannot be seen as endorsing any specific economic or political vision, it can only be interpreted as an empowerment to articulate such a vision. But it is uncertain, and here lies another paradox, it is uncertain to whom this empowerment is given, and under what processes any ensuing decisions are to be taken. In other words, the referendum has prompted delegation of power to political agents in a way that highly enhances their discretion and may end up increasing the powers of the executive vis-a-vis those of the parliament. The government has been very keen to rule out the possibility of another referendum to decide on the terms of membership. And the truth is, I think that the debate occurs in an uncomfortable constitutional vacuum. To hold another referendum is as legitimate as not to hold another referendum. I don't think any side can hear, at the very least, I think, and I'm trying to keep this really as a reflection on political economy, as a reflection on governance, in line with the objectives of the seminar. So I think, at the very least, it is, to my mind, fair to say that no side has the high moral ground. It is as legitimate to hold another referendum as not to hold another referendum. But I think that although the referendum, the holding of the referendum, the decision to give this question to the people, has been hailed as a triumph of direct democracy, it is governments rather than citizens who end up being the winners. And that is both for the reasons that I explained, and also both, it is further, I think, countenanced by the way, by political developments in the post-referendum times. I think, to give a very concrete example, which I think for lawyers is pivotal, in that it concerns us as lawyers. The government is planning to enact a great repeal bill. It's not going to be called that, by the way, because there are limitations on what you can call bills of what you can call acts of parliament. So this kind of triumphalism is not going to be reflected in the name of the bill. And the intention of the government, which appears to me to be very sensible, indeed the only option, is to maintain in force English law, or British law if you wish, that implements EU directives, and until and unless the government decides to amend it. So at time zero, as it were, at the time of exit, domestic law will reflect EU law, and then it will be at the discretion of the government whether to amend it or not. Now, for this to operate, it will need an extensive use of delegated legislation. It is not possible for the Parliament to do that, to do either the amendments or to take care of any consequential points, which means a heavy reliance on Henry VIII clauses, the ability of the administration to change, amend, repeat acts of Parliament, and that, for obvious reasons, raises concerns about democratic accountability. So this aspect, in other words, the effect of the referendum and the interplay between direct and indirect democracy, it seems to me to be a very important point which in many respects lies at the center of the discussion. Okay, more reflections before we get to the legal issues of Article 50. One of the issues that we might want to think about is this: why should free movement of workers be linked inextricably with the other freedoms? The idea is that one of the main concerns, and this is the perception that it is immigration what has made the difference. And why has immigration made the difference? Because I cannot verify the data, at least not yet, for the following reason: that there has been a qualitative difference in the type of immigration that has occurred over the last 14, 15 years. In other words, since 2003. 2003 is the year of the accession of Central and Eastern European states to the EU. 10 new countries, 10 countries rather, became member states of the European Union. And that led to a qualitatively different kind of migration. Why? Because until then, migration to the United Kingdom centered on urban centers. Most of it was in London, but a lot of it was in Birmingham, it was in Manchester, it was in Liverpool, it was in the big cities, Glasgow and Edinburgh of Scotland. Post 2003, a lot of the migration was not in the big urban centers, it was in smaller towns, and this changed demographically the composition of the towns. It brought a different kind of impact, if you wish, on social and economic life in this country. What is the reason for that? The reason for that was the economic difference between East European countries and the United Kingdom, which was enormous. It was much larger than, for example, the economic differential between South European countries and the United Kingdom when they entered in the 1980s. So, this may, as I said, this really, all these data are derivative. I haven't by no means done the research by myself. It's beyond my payroll. I think it is the economists who have looked at those data. And I understand this to be the claim that I made verified by demographic and economic analysis. So, the question I suppose to ask is this: well, if migration is the key problem, why can we not separate it from the other freedoms? After all, I said earlier that the United Kingdom is a very important player. I think it has been a success story, economic success story over the last 30 years. Why should Europe not give to the United Kingdom what it wishes, provide an exception from free movement of workers while retaining the other three freedoms? I don't think the question has anything to do with morals. I mean, political negotiations, everything is up for grabs. And it may make sense. The trade-off may well be beneficial. You keep being a powerful member state, the overall effect is good for Europe. So why should the European Union have such a dogmatic, if you wish, devotion to the indivisibility of the four freedoms. So how would a pro-European answer this? I suppose the counter-arguments are the following. Again, I'm not saying whether they're correct or incorrect, I'm just trying to present them. One is an ideological argument. The universality of the four freedoms, free movement of goods, persons, services and capital, is, has always been the leitmotif of European Union law. And free movement of persons goes to the very heart of the identity of the EU construct, the integration construct. It was not envisaged as a free trade agreement, it was not envisaged as a customs union, it was envisaged as a common market in pursuit of an ever closer union. Why is that? Because really the European Union is, if you wish, a process of catharsis. It comes in the aftermath of the two world wars that tore Europe apart in the 20th century. And I think the best way of encapsulating it is the way that a member of Jean Monnet's team that I met, not one of the few surviving members of his team that I met long time ago, and he said to me, the European Union really is about this. There is a school in Scotland, in Edinburgh, which was built in the 10th of the 19th to the 20th century. And it has three pillars. It's neoclassical style. It has three pillars. And in 1918, one of the pillars was filled up with the names of the pupils that died in the First World War. And then in 1945, the second pillar was filled up with the names of the pupils that perished in the Second World War. And he said to me, the EU is so that the third pillar stays empty, which it illustrates that it is a story that I suspect can be replicated in many places around Europe, not only in the United Kingdom. And it, to my mind, it epitomizes the idea of European integration as a process of catharsis, a process that tries to undo the conflicts between European states in the first half of the 20th century. So, seen in that context, ideologically, there is a point to be made about the indivisibility of the four freedoms. There is a second point which derives from the first, and this is an argument based on equality and fair treatment. It is what the Americans express as the swim or sink together philosophy. We are all in this together. All member states should be treated equally. You should not allow one member state a special deal. These are philosophical arguments. I think there are political arguments to support the same view. If a concession is given to the United Kingdom, other EU states will begin to cherry pick. So refusal of a special arrangement to the United Kingdom is necessary to control centrifugal forces. It is a political imperative to ensure that the whole edifice stays together. One can go on about this. As I said, there was a deal in 2016, in March 2016, in favor of the UK. The UK got the deal, nothing happened. So who is to say that even if the deal gets better now, the UK will decide to stay in. So giving more concessions does not necessarily have the desired result. But this is something that we need to think very seriously about. What is it really so special about the four freedoms and the idea of migration that it should not be touched upon? Because it goes back to the central point of the talk, which is the relationship between rights, citizen rights, and sovereign powers. A point which is a reflection really from discussions I've had with politicians, and what I find, especially talking to members of the House of Lords, but also to the Commons, is this idea of punishment. The idea is that Europe should not punish the United Kingdom by giving it a bad deal. It is a very prevalent rhetoric. And I think the rhetoric of punishment is misguided. And it is misguided for the following reasons. I don't think morality has anything to do with international politics. I think if you have a change in the political status quo, inevitably you have winners and losers. The UK decides to leave the European Union. The losers in this case are EU citizens who will have fewer rights. Okay. But I don't think it is correct to say that those who voted in favour of the EU or in favour of the UK to leave the EU did so to punish EU citizens. I think that would be misconceived. So to say that the EU will give a bad deal to the UK to punish it, I think it really is is fallacious. I would view it in the following terms. I think there is undoubtedly a sovereign right to withdraw from the European Union. A member state may decide to exercise it, and I think this is undeniable. I think we also have to accept that other countries may decide to belong to an international organization. And it is that for the members of the organization to decide what would be the perceived advantages of membership that will be denied to those who are not members. It's like belonging to a club. It is for the members of a club to decide what are the privileges of the club members that will be exclusive to the club members and not be made available to those who are not members of the club. So that may well create, if you wish, collaterally adverse effects for the non-members. I think that's undoubtedly correct. But I don't think the idea of punishing, the idea of doing something with the intention of making life worse for someone else, I think is the wrong way of thinking about it. And I think this is important. Why? Because if you think that if you interpret political deals from the viewpoint of punishment, I think you misunderstand the negotiating intentions of the other party, and you will end up with a less good deal. Okay. Do I need to shut up?
No, you do not. Okay. It's illuminating. Please continue.
So here then is some reflections on Article 50 and on rights. Article 50 is the provision in the Treaty of the European Union that governs the process of withdrawal. Okay, and effectively, it provides for the following steps. First, a member state that wishes to withdraw has to give notification to the European Council. The notification triggers the beginning of a two-year period within which a withdrawal agreement can be negotiated. If a withdrawal agreement is not negotiated within 2 years, then Article 50 states EU law ceases to apply to the withdrawn member state unless the parties unanimously agree to extend the negotiating period. So what does Article 50 tell us in terms of international governance, in terms of federalism? Okay, if you look at federal states, or federations, one might be able to classify membership into three categories. One is the federal model. The federal model allows no exit. You cannot exit. There is no provision that allows exit. The American Constitution is a good example. Why does the American Constitution not have an Article 15? Because they've had a civil war for it, and decided that there is going to be a federal state. It was the result of the outcome of the civil war in the U.S. was to have this federal model. Second model, I suppose, is the federal control model, which allows withdrawal subject to certain conditions. So, yes, the constituent parts of the organization may call it a day, but they would need to, the decision is under some kind of control by the overarching organization. And finally, there is the state control model, where each of the constituent parts can do whatever they like. Soviet Union is a good example. In fact, there was a right for each of the members of the Soviet Union, the republics of the Soviet Union, to withdraw if they wanted. I think it would have been highly unwise for the politicians who decided to do that. But it was in the treaties establishing the Soviet Union. So where does the EU fall into this? I suppose it falls into the second category, the federal control model. However, the control here is procedural, it is not substantial. There is absolutely no doubt that a member state of the European Union has a sovereign right to withdraw. And Article 50 provides for a process. It provides for a two-year period within which the negotiations are to be conducted, but it states squarely and clearly, in the absence of a withdrawal agreement, within 2 years' time, the treaty ceases to apply to the withdrawing member state. There is a lot of talk, again, going back to the point I made about punishment, there is a lot of talk about Article 50 making life difficult for the withdrawing state. A lot of you may have seen it in the news. I have certainly been confronted with this question in many committees. And the idea is that Article 50 is against the UK, makes life very difficult for the United Kingdom. I just think this is, again, it's a fallacy. It doesn't withstand an analysis. And why does it not withstand an analysis? Well, I simply don't think that Article 50 loads the dice either against or in favor of the withdrawing state. All it does is to provide for a two-year period within which a withdrawal agreement may be negotiated. And why does it not load the dice? Well, first, you have to compare Article 50 with something else. If you really think it makes it worse for the withdrawing state, I suppose the question is, I would ask two questions. Did the withdrawing state suggest something else when Article 50 was adopted? The answer to that is no. If you look back to the travaux préparatoire of Article 50 and its predecessor, the United Kingdom considered that there is no need to have a withdrawal provision because that was assumed under international law. Then the policy of the government changed, and Jack Straw, when he was foreign minister, said Article 50 is a good idea because it crystallizes and makes clear what is the position in international law. Nobody, neither the United Kingdom nor any other member state, has been on record as providing an alternative procedure that would supposedly make it easier for a withdrawing state. Secondly, the default position would have been the Vienna Convention on the Law of Treaties, which would have provided for a year instead of 2 years. I think providing for 2 years is more in line with the integration paradigm, because the degree of interaction of the member states as a result of the EU treaty is more intense and it is more extensive. So the idea is, if you want to disentangle yourself, you should have the chance of negotiating something in 2 years. A third point, and I think really this to my mind is the most important argument. The truth is, you don't know how in the event of withdrawal, what would be the preferences of each of the parties. If your preference is to get rid of a member state, then 2 years is a very long time to wait. Okay? It works to the disadvantage of the EU. If you think that you want to withdraw, but you want to take your time to withdraw and make sure there is little disruption, then you would want more than 2 years, and consider 2 years to be too short. If you want to emancipate yourself from the EU as soon as possible, then 2 years is a bad idea. But the truth is, when the article is drafted, you don't know who would want what in the event of withdrawal. So how can you tell that this, in fact, works to the disadvantage of one or the other party? In a nutshell, what Article 50 does, very simply, is to crystallize the bargaining asymmetry in the position of the parties. To put it in plain language, the more powerful economically and politically the withdrawing state, the better the deal it is likely to get. That would have been the case anyway. What Article 50 does is to put that in legal language. Is the withdrawal, is the notification to withdraw reversible? To my mind, it is reversible. Yes, I think this is supported by the text of Article 50, by the Vienna Convention, also by a proposed interpretation. I'm happy to come back to that. But to my mind, the power to withdraw notification of withdrawal is the other side of the sovereign decorum. Just as I have the sovereign right to withdraw, I also have the sovereign right to change my mind until the 2 year period finishes. In other words, the crossing of the Rubicon is not the submission of the, it's not the notification of withdrawal, but it is the expiry of the 2 year time limit. This, by the way, was not argued in the Miller case. As you know, this is the case where the Court of Justice, the Supreme Court in this country decided that parliamentary involvement was necessary to give notification. The issue was left open. And the issue was left open because both sides, it was convenient for both sides. The applicants did not want to admit that notification could be withdrawn, because they thought that might prejudice their argument that the notification changes rights. The government side, on the other hand, did not want to admit that withdrawal is possible, because that would be an embarrassment given the official line of the government would take. So I think withdrawal is possible. Another aspect of Article 50 is, to my mind, that it decouples the withdrawal agreement from the future the agreement that will govern the future trading relationship between the withdrawn state on the one hand and the European Union. The two are different. Okay, I think that's important to emphasize, and they are different because they are governed by different processes. From the point of view of the EU, this is important. The withdrawal agreement is concluded by the EU by a majority of 20 member states. It suffices to have 20 out of the 27 to conclude the withdrawal agreement, to conclude a trade agreement between the EU and the United Kingdom. You would need, depending on what the agreement says, but you would probably need unanimity, and it is also probable that the agreement will be a mixed one, which means that it will be signed not only by the EU, but also by the member states acting individually, the way the agreement with Canada was concluded, which means that it would require ratification by the individual parliaments of the member states, including in the case of some states, regional or local parliaments, totaling 36 ratification procedures. So you cannot mix the two. You cannot put in the withdrawal agreement clauses that can only go to the future agreement, which raises in turn the legal question, what can and what cannot be included in the withdrawal agreement. Right, I'm going to finish just to outline an issue which is really the central issue in the whole thing. And this is, what about citizen rights? Is there any limit in what can be done? And I think in the withdrawal agreement there are clear limits, because the withdrawal agreement is below, ranks in law below the EU treaties. So it is bound by fundamental rights, it is bound by the Charter. And there are certain things which the EU cannot conclude. Would, in the absence of any agreement, citizens have any acquired rights? And to my mind, they would, under EU law. Okay, I know this is controversial, but to my mind, EU law and the idea of citizenship, EU citizenship, creates a residue of rights that citizens can accept. The trouble with that is that they can only accept them as a matter of EU law, therefore they can only accept them against the EU and its member states. They cannot accept them against the United Kingdom. If I am correct, that leads to a very odd situation where a British citizen living in Europe can assert those rights against the country where it lives in, but an EU citizen living in the United Kingdom cannot assert them against the United Kingdom. It's, let's say, a view that has made me unpopular when presented in certain states, but to my mind, if EU is to mean something, I think that must be the case. The Court of Justice, which is really what constitutionalized European Union law, declared back in the 1960s that the European Union is more than an agreement which conforms to the traditional Westphalian concept of international law. It creates more than reciprocal rights and obligations among states, it gives rights to citizens that become part of the legal heritage. So this, combined with the fact that the agreement is concluded for an unlimited duration, appears to me to suggest that under certain circumstances, I'm happy to give examples, EU citizens living within EU territory, they can assert certain rights either against the EU or the member states, irrespective of the decision of a member state to leave the European Union. As I said, this would not help EU citizens living in the UK, but it would work the other way around. Just a final point on the issue of rights. The House of Lords Select Committee issued a report a week ago, and it takes the view that the Vienna Convention on International Treaties, Article 70, paragraph 1b, which states that pre-existing international obligations cannot be negated by withdrawal from the international agreement, does not apply in the case of the EU. In other words, in plain language, what the House of Lords means is that the United Kingdom can walk out without having to make any contributions to the EU budget, even in relation to obligations that it has undertaken before it leaves the European Union. By the same token, I suppose a judgment issued by the European Court of Justice, which requires a government to provide a remedy to an EU citizen, need no longer be complied with after withdrawal. To my mind, this is a profoundly wrong interpretation. The issue was discussed extensively in the House of Lords. They expressly rejected my view, so it was negative impact.
Still impact.
Thank you for listening. I spoke for too long.
No, you didn't. It was wonderful.